Good day and welcome to all of you. As usual, I'm back with an interesting topic which I have been observing for a very, very long time. And while welcoming all of you, I just wanted to specially welcome Vinita, because the moment we start off at 2 o'clock sharp, she's the first one to say good afternoon, Ali, and everyone. So a special good afternoon to you, Vinita, and of course to all the others. And as you have just seen, what we are going to be discussing today is setting boundaries in relationships. Now, I have been telling time and again that relationships are the most important aspect of human life, and there is no other single factor which, you know, contributes to your happiness, well-being, and fulfillment as relationships. It is, according to me, you may agree or disagree, but according to me, it is the most important factor which determines our well-being. If you have good relationships, you're a very happy and contented person. If your relationships go bad, whatever may be your success otherwise, in terms of, you know, having good wealth or good health or good job or good resources or whatever it is, but still somehow or the other, you're not as satisfied as a person as you would be if you have good relationships. I've also given you examples that, you know, whenever something good or something bad happens to you, the first thing that you want to do is to share it with your near and dear. If there are people to support you, to encourage you, to even stand by you when you are going through a bad time, and you can happily share with them, then the intensity of that negative thing that is happening gets reduced. Same thing with good news, that the good news gets doubled when you can share it with somebody and say, hey, I have done this, or I have achieved this, or whatever it is. That's how relationships go. But today what we are going to talk about is setting boundaries in relationships. See, every relationship, you cannot allow it to overwhelm you or to override you. So every now and then it does happen that somebody wants to become a dominant person in a relationship. Somebody wants to put others down. Somebody wants to, you know, gain control over other people in terms of relationships. And that can happen at any level. It happens in the family. One family member may want to dominate and have his or her presence, you know, and what I say is right and you have to listen to me, that type of thing. There may be others who want to take advantage and say, I will do what I want. You can't dictate to me. I will tell you what to do. This can happen beyond family, in the neighborhood, among your friends, among your, you know, people whom you socialize with. And it can also happen in an office environment. So you're working somewhere and you have people around you, you have colleagues, you have customers. And there again, there could be certain things which are happening. So what we are going to discuss today is, how do you ensure that you do not allow anybody to take advantage of their relationship with you? And that is why I have used the word setting boundaries. So setting boundaries is primarily to be able to say that I am okay with this, but I'm not okay with that. And this can vary not only from person to person, it can vary from time to time. So starting with children, for example, a child, when he is small, may allow his parent to completely dominate over him. As he grows up, he feels that I should be given a little more autonomy. I should be given a little bit of independence. You should not interfere in certain things of my life. So even a growing child has the right to set boundaries. We have simple things, for example, you know, where a teenager says to the parent that don't come into my room without knocking. Now it is debatable whether the parent has to knock and then enter into the child's room or not. Nobody, no third person can actually dictate terms and say this is right and that is wrong. But when a person has certain wishes, desires, let's say this child for whatever reason feels that my parents should not walk into my room when I am alone and when I close the door. So what is the child trying to say? The child is trying to set boundaries. But the parent may have a completely different view of that. The parent may say, no, I am your parent. What is it that you are doing which is so great a secret which you want to hide from me and do? In fact, you're making me more suspicious by making such a statement. So I'm definitely going to come and see what you are doing. So as I said, there is no right and wrong. There are no norms which you can dictate and say this is the thing. But if you as a person, and I'm using adolescents only as an example, I'm now talking more about adults. As an adult, you have a right to have certain boundaries. Now this starts with your social circles. You can draw three circles around you. The first one is your intimate circle. People with whom you're very intimate, you're very close, and there are no barriers, there are no hindrances, there's no privacy required. The next is what we call as the personal circle. So maybe my siblings, my relatives, my whatever, people whom I consider as part of my family or extended family or somebody. So what do I allow them? To what extent do I allow them to come into my privacy or into my boundary? The third is, the work or social or those type of circles. So people whom you work with or your neighbors or your friends or whatever. Maybe you have some domestic help at home or anybody like that. And beyond that third circle is the people whom you have very casual acquaintances with. It could be a shopkeeper, it could be a cab driver, it could be somebody whom you have occasional interaction with. But the interesting thing is that boundaries always help in any of these circles, in any of these relationships. When I said about intimate relationships, I said that, maybe somebody with whom you have no reason to have any hindrances or anything, but yet I insist that even there should be boundaries. Sometimes people who are very close to each other, one person starts taking advantage of the other. One person starts intruding too much into the other's life. The person wants to know exactly where you went, whom you met, what are you doing. One of the common things these days which keep popping up every now and then in counseling situation is, for example, a spouse checking the spouse's mobile phone. So when the other person has left his mobile and gone for a bath or gone out or whatever it is, the other spouse starts, going through the mobile and checking what were the messages, what were the conversations, whom this person was talking to. The other person may not like it. The other person. So if this person says that, this is the thing, what is there between you and me? Why should there be secrets? It's not even a question of secrets. It's a question of what you are comfortable with and what you are not comfortable with. So based on that, what I feel is, in every relationship, starting from your intimate to the personal to the social, we should define these boundaries. You should set boundaries beforehand. The sad part is that the discussion or the argument start when there is a conflict. So like I said, a spouse is checking the spouse's mobile phone. And then the argument starts. So one person feels very self-righteous in saying, what is it that you are hiding? Why is it that I can't check your phone? The other person says it's not a question of hiding, it's a question of my privacy as an adult, that I have the right to have certain privacies. But if they had sat down when things were good, when there was no argument, and if they had set boundaries, the same way when a child is growing up, I give the example, if the parent and child come to an understanding before this situation arises, that I will enter into your room or I will not enter into your room, or this is what I will do and this is what I will not do, this is what I expect from you and this is what I do not expect from you. The flip side of it is, you know, what happens is that some people set boundaries which are very rigid and they don't give explanations. That is when relationships go bad. If somebody tells, I don't want you to touch my phone, or I don't want you to enter into my room without knocking, and no explanation is given. So what is human behavior? What are you hiding from me? Why are you putting this restriction? So I always feel that when you want to set a boundary, please explain. Explain that this is what I feel when this happens. Or this is what I'm used to. Or this is how my upbringing has been, because of which I want to maintain this level of privacy or these boundaries in these relationships. Overall, I would say that some amount of privacy, some amount of restrictions, some amount of boundaries are good for every relationship, however close it is. Because otherwise, without realizing, you may start, you know, stamping in each other's toes or getting into somebody's uncomfortable zone. So whoever it is with whom you have a fairly good, you know, relationship, discuss it beforehand. At the same time, I want to add, ask yourself before you set boundaries whether it is because of past experience. Somebody has had a girlfriend, boyfriend, and something went wrong in that relationship. It is quite understandable that when the person goes into a new relationship, he or she starts putting boundaries straight away because I have already had a bad experience. And it's not just in intimate relationships. It could be money matters. I've had a bad experience when I dealt with money with somebody. I got cheated or I got let down. And now that I'm going into a transaction with somebody, I'm doubly careful. Don't do that, is what I say. Don't carry the past into the present relationship. Whatever boundaries you want to set up, do it for the specific relationship which now you have with a particular person. Define them and then go ahead. Okay. So I have listed down a few points which are like, you know, to be able to help you how to understand that there is a need to, you know, have boundaries in relationships, how you set it up, what do you do if there is resistance from the other side, and what are the advantages in the long run, how you can get this. So this Sonal has made into a nice PPT as usual. You know, audiovisual always has a better impact. So now Anis will show you these things one by one. You can have a look and you will know what I'm talking about in terms of setting boundaries. Here you see a boundary which is a physical fence, but what I am talking about is boundaries at the mental or the emotional level. Okay. So it starts with clarifying, telling the other person concerned, this I am okay with, but that I am not okay with. Sometimes people have this thing that, you know, don't ask me about money matters. You can ask me about my house or my relationships or something, or vice versa. I have no hangabouts about telling about money matters. But when you talk about something which is emotional, which is personal and private to me, I get a little, you know, put off by that. So in any relationship that is important to you, as I said, even things are going good, when there is no conflict, when there are no unpleasantness, start off with defining that there are certain areas which I'm very comfortable with, and there are certain areas which I'm not comfortable with. Take a simple thing like touch. Certain people are not very comfortable with somebody coming and putting their arm around or hugging them, however close those people are. That's how they're built. So if they tell them that I am okay if you want to shake hands with me, or I'm okay if you want to sit next to me, but I'm not very comfortable if somebody puts an arm around or somebody wants a hug or whatever it is. I prefer, I can hug children, but with adults, I'm a little uncomfortable because that's how my upbringing has been. Maybe I'll take time, but right now this is what my limitation is. So start off by telling what you are okay with and what you are not okay with, and give an explanation. And that is why I have put down in this second slide, do not be too rigid without explanation. I told, gave you the example of the mobile phone or the door or whatever it may be. Somebody who's fairly close to you says, you know, tell me what's your salary or how much you are earning or anything like that. And this person says, no, I don't like to tell. Now, why is it? What is so personal about it? What is so secretive about it that you don't want to tell? So, you know, a lot of misunderstandings, a lot of unpleasantness takes place when you become too rigid and too firm and too clear. That's why in the first one I told you, this I'm okay with, that I'm not okay with. And wherever you are not okay, give an explanation. I gave you the example of touch. This is how I've been brought up, you know. In our family, people don't hug each other or, you know, put arms around each other somehow. I know it may not be the very right thing to do, but that's how I am. So please respect this thing that I don't like this. Whereas if there's anything else about, you know, let's say sharing of money or doing something else, I'm perfectly okay with it. So keep this thing in mind. Then I was telling you, figure out from past experience. Before you encounter somebody else and tell them, you know, what your boundaries are or what you like or what you don't like, please take the trouble of figuring out from your past experience. I had a friend and I did some, you know, favor by giving some money or something, and that friend cheated me. Not only cheated me, went about telling everybody bad things about me, whereas he owes me money. But to defend himself, what he did was, he went about telling, saying that I owe him money. Now I get so upset that whenever somebody talks about money matters, I become very cold. And this new person will be wondering, what has happened? Why can't you trust me? Why do you have to be so rigid? So that's why I always feel that we should take time to stop, introspect, and find out what we are uncomfortable with. Then comes the slightly difficult part for those of us who are not very assertive or firm, or who are not used to being rigid with people. You know what we do? We say sorry. The person is asking, you know, how much salary you get. Or the person is trying to put his arm around me and I'm pulling myself away. Don't be apologetic. Don't say, sorry, I'm not able to tell you. Why should you say sorry? Have you done something wrong? No, you haven't. So what you need to do is to first make a statement. I am not comfortable with, that was the first thing I started off with. I'm not comfortable with money matters. I am not comfortable with people coming too close to me. I am not comfortable in sharing issues about my family. But it should not be sorry. Why should you be sorry? Then you are not comfortable. You have a right to say. And as I said, the only thing that you perhaps you can do is to give a reason, to explain why you are not comfortable about it, and then face the person firmly and say, this is what the thing is. Now be prepared. When you start setting some boundaries, when you tell somebody that, no, this I am not willing to give you. Supposing you have a neighbor or a friend or a relative who wants to borrow something from you. They want to take your vehicle. Now, you may be the type of person who takes intense care of your vehicle. You look after it so well. Everything from A to Z, you look after your vehicle perfectly. And you are not happy with the idea of somebody else using your vehicle. So if that person comes and says, can I borrow your vehicle? Anyway, you're not using it today, no? So can I borrow it for 2 hours? I'll come back and I'll return it to you. And if you say no, remember that the other person can either be genuinely unhappy, hurt. You don't trust me by giving me your vehicle for even 2 hours. Or the person may be that dominating type of person who tries to emotionally blackmail you. If you hear somebody making statements like, what do you think, I'll take it and run away, is it? Or you think, I don't know how to drive, is it? I've driven much bigger and much more expensive vehicles than this. Do not succumb to emotional blackmail. Be ready that the initial response may be bad. And why does that happen? Because in close relationships, a lot of people expect no boundaries. Hey, yeah, you are my childhood friend. Why can't you tell me about your relationship with your spouse? We know each other so well. Can't you trust me by giving me this loan? I will return it to you within a few days. I have been so nice to you in so many ways. Can't you be nice to me? Why are you resisting? Why are you putting away this thing? So understand that people expect that in close relationships, there are going to be no boundaries. That's what people think. They have a right to think that way. Maybe that's how they want to lead their life. Maybe this is what they put into practice. But it doesn't mean that you have to oblige them. So like I said, you don't even have to say sorry. You just have to explain a little bit and say, there are certain areas where I am not comfortable. Okay, now what happens if you keep giving in to people? One of the most, you know, unfortunate thing that can happen and which can create a lot of problems for you is people start expecting more and more from you. You lend 1,000 rupees, before you know it, the person returns it, comes back and asks for 10,000 rupees. You know all these money scams that take place. What they do is, we'll give you, you know, 25% interest, 30% interest, and they take a small amount from you and they pay you the interest and you're very happy. I get 6 or 8 or maximum 10% interest, and here somebody is giving me 25% interest. But you know what they do? Next time they ask for a bigger amount. And when they give you the interest, now you're thrilled and they ask for a huge amount and you give it to them. So that is what I want you to protect yourself from. That be aware that if you open the doors, there are some people, I'm not saying everybody does that, but there are definitely some people who start expecting more and more from you. So it is better to nip it in the bud and say, you're a good friend of mine or you're my close relative, but I am the type of person who does not get into money matters with close people. I neither ask for a loan nor do I give a loan. Or I'm a little particular, or maybe you can call me possessive about my vehicle. I take very good care of my vehicle and I want the vehicle only to remain with me. And that is why I don't like to lend. It's not that I don't trust you or anything like that. But this is a policy which I have. I hope and wish that you will respect this boundary and you will understand. Okay. Then comes a very important area. what happens if somebody breaks those boundaries? What happens if people take advantage of you? It can happen, no? However much you are careful, however much you may be, you know, trying to protect yourself, somebody may break that boundary. If that happens, you have to get into damage control. Nowadays, you may be coming across in the media of instances where minors are driving huge vehicles belonging to their rich parent, speeding, overspeeding, driving without a license, driving under the influence of alcohol, resulting in deaths of innocent people who are there on the road or on the footpath. Now, why does that happen? Because the parent did not set boundaries. You are not 18 years old. You may be my only child. I may be having a fleet of cars, but you are not going to drive a car till you turn 18 and you get a driving license. Same thing, we have been having a lot of instances. We ourselves have faced, you know, such cases, very unfortunate. Young boys making a gang, morphing photos of girls and circulating them, leading to very, very distressful situation for the girls concerned. Again, it's the same thing. The child is given a smartphone at a very early age. No boundaries have been set. There are indicators that he has misused the phone. Still, the parents have not confiscated or not reprimanded him. And then he goes on and on and on and doing all these type of things. So what we need to do is to start small. Express clearly. No, all my friends are driving their parents' vehicles. What's wrong with it? What's wrong with it? If you want to know, come and sit. I'll explain to you. But don't come and tell me that all my friends are driving, therefore I want this. All my friends have got a very expensive smartphone, so I should also have that. All my friends lend me their vehicles. Why can't you lend me your vehicle? Be very clear. I do not want to generalize. I do not want to know what others are doing. Talk about what we are doing. Understand also at this juncture the difference between needs and wants. If the person genuinely needs something, maybe you can stretch the boundary a little bit to fulfill his need. But keep in mind that very, very often it is wants and not needs. If that person doesn't have a vehicle today, he can catch a bus or a metro or an auto or cab, and he can still go and do whatever work he has. So asking for your vehicle is a want. It is not a need. But if that person has somebody who is sick and has to be immediately taken to the hospital and no ambulance or cab is coming in, that is a need. Maybe you can, if you decide, you know, stretch your boundaries and give those things to them. Finally, what I wanted to tell you is to learn this skill called assertiveness. What is assertiveness in simple terms? It is the, you know, golden mean between aggressiveness, dominating on one side, and submissiveness and passiveness on the other side. If you learn the in-between, the golden mean, where you learn to be assertive. I will do a program, a big program someday on building assertiveness, but you can also look it up and you can find out how to do it. Please start building that assertiveness. Your relationships will go very well and you will be able to have the boundaries without getting into any problems. Okay. So this is what I wanted to convey to you. And Purnima is here. She'll just quickly update on what's happening here and check out with you. And then I'll be back.
Hi, good afternoon. So, is it raining in your area? Yesterday there was so much of rains. Last few days there is. Hi, Vinita. Can also give your respect and trust in yes. So I'll wait for Ali to reply to this. Hey, Rihanna. So it's been raining and drizzling, and the weather has suddenly gone from super, say duper, right? And it's really very nice. I think we've come back to the old Bangalore weather, henna. It used to be so warm, 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 and they would all say, "This is not Bangalore. It was not like this." And now we say, "This is Bangalore. It is like this." Good afternoon to all of y'all. Love you lots. And I thought I'll give you one update. What happens is, you know, now we do a lot of career counseling, right? And nowadays the demand, as we can say, for psychology and the related careers has gone up tremendously. So the thing that happens is that many of them are very confused, you know. Hey, good to hear so many good afternoons. So many of them are really, you know, very confused as to what career options they should take, what should be, as we call, as their domain specialization. So what we have done is, there's a lot of glare. So what we have done is that we are holding a free webinar. It's going to be mentored by Ali, and it is on the 2nd of August from 4:30 to 5:30 for 1 hour, and it is for psychology students, for counselors, for teachers, anyone, you know, who is interested in human behavior and who wants to take his career forward in that direction. What we are doing is, we are conducting a free webinar, and we will be sending across the details to you in the next week. Also, the poster will come across. So that is for generally people to understand what domain specializations to take, because if they make an informed decision, at least their career path can get a lot more easier according to what their capability and interests are, you know. So that's just our humble contribution to so many students, teachers, counselors, homemakers, and so many different people who are interested in human behavior, who want to know how to steer their career in psychology forward. It's a webinar. So pan India, pan world, pan Bangalore, everywhere they can join us. We will be sending the link, Google form, and they can call up Anis or office and register also. So it'll be really very nice if you can help people to understand this and spread the word. All right. So I'll see you soon. And Ali is here. And Ali, lots of thoughts coming in for you. So Ali is going to join you in a
Angel,
bit.
wishes to you.
Yes, wishes to me also have come, and lots of questions are already in, and they are waiting for you to give your thoughts. So over to Ali.
Yes. Let us start off. Vinita says, sometimes I feel setting boundaries can also give you respect and trust in relationships. Yes, it's a good comment. In fact, it adds on to what I was saying about assertiveness. When you develop assertiveness and you tell somebody, no, I don't want to lend my vehicle to you. No, I don't want to get into money transactions with you or whatever it is. When you do that, initially be ready for a negative, response. What is it? Don't you trust me? What's so great about it? If I was there, I would have lent you this or I would have done that. Ignore. That's the beauty of assertiveness. You allow the person to go ahead. In the long run, remember, people not only trust, but also respect people who are assertive, who set boundaries with an explanation that this I can do, this I cannot do. So Vinita is absolutely right. Next one. Surekha says, we need to set boundaries in order to own our own power and owning our own emotions. This way, we don't allow people to derail us from our path of personal growth. Very well put, as always, Surekha. The point is that you are telling people, or you're telling yourself firstly, that I own my own emotions. And remember, I have a right to my emotions. I have a right to my own boundaries. It could be with regard to my body. It could be with regard to my money. It could be with regard to my feelings and my well-being. But I own my emotions and I will stand by it. I will not allow anybody to intrude into my emotions the same way as I'm not intruding into somebody else's emotions. So remember that also, you have to be very clear. You can't intrude into other people and then tell them that, no, I have set boundaries. You can't, borrow money from somebody and when they come, you can't say that, no, I don't lend money. That also you should keep in mind, right? Okay, Surekha also says, putting up your boundary means you are saying, I know who I am. I know what is right and what is wrong. And I will teach you how to treat me by what I allow and what I don't. I don't mind being patient with you. I will give you explanations. I'll tell you what I feel and why I feel in a particular manner. I will take it slow and easy. I'm not going to be very rigid or be very curt or rude to you. But I will stand by you. I will empathize with you. Yes, I understand that going by public vehicle will be a little inconvenient to you. That's why you wanted to borrow my vehicle. But since I have certain restrictions, I have certain norms. It's nothing to do with you personally. It's not that I don't trust you with the vehicle. It's not that I'm thinking that you'll either run away with the vehicle or you'll put it in an accident or something. No, not at all. But it is just that this is the way I treat my vehicle. This is the way I treat my body. This is the way I treat my money. This is the way I treat my relationships. That's also equally important. Okay, Mangala says, hi Ali, there are few relatives who hardly ask any help. But mind in mind, they have expectations of financial help. But at the same time, they are too selfish. Sometimes I feel guilty not satisfying their expectations. Their expectations. They can have any expectations. Let's say there are relatives who have an expectation. Let us live in your house, you go and live in a rented house. Why do you need such a big house? You are only three of you, we are six of us. Logically correct. But would you like to do that? Obviously not. Because if you do that, as I mentioned in the slide, their expectation grows up. There are extreme cases. I know of a person who had bought a new vehicle and was planning to sell the old one. When one of his friends came and said, can I use your older vehicle for some time? He gave it. He shouldn't have. He succumbed because that man was showing, how badly he needs a vehicle or whatever. He was giving him some excuse. He lent it to him. Now, whenever he would ask for the vehicle back, the person would say, what's the hurry? Anyway, you're going to sell it off. You're not going to use it, no? But I'm using it. I need it now. I have to drop my child at school. I have to take my mother to the hospital. I have to do this. I have to do that. And he kept on and on and on. And this man who had not learned assertiveness did not take the vehicle back until one fine day, the person who had borrowed the vehicle comes to him and says, the insurance has to be renewed. Will you please pay the insurance premium and give me the papers? Thankfully, at that time, something snapped. And he just went over to that man's place and said, give me the keys of the car. I'll get the insurance renewed. And he took the car and went away and told him, I'm not giving it back to you. Why create such a situation? See, you know that that person doesn't desperately need your car, and you know that you're going to sell the car and you want that money. So why succumb just because that person gives you a sob story, right? Okay, Mangala also says, yeah, this I've already. Sureka says, if you keep your boundaries, those who are angry at you will have to learn self-control instead of other control. Very true, as far as you are concerned. But there's another interesting fact I want you to keep in mind. They know that they cannot control you. There are these people who don't learn self-control. You know what they do? They go looking for other bakras. This person is very clear, very assertive. This person will not give me what I want. So I'll go and look for somebody who is soft. Now that we cannot handle, no? We cannot interfere in other people's lives, and we cannot go about trying to, you know, be sort of saviors to everybody. Let them go and do whatever they want. If the other person obliges, it's up to them. We will not interfere. But once I have made myself very clear, assertively, that I'm not going to give, they do back off. There is no boundary, Sureka says, which helps you to say, you don't get to tell me how I feel about myself. This is the boundary that helps you to keep your power. Please underline what Sureka has said. You don't get to tell me how I feel about myself. You have no right about on my feelings, my emotions, even my attitudes, my values, the way I want to lead my life. You don't have a right to do that. Yes, you have a right to ask for something. I want money, I want a vehicle, I want you to come with me here, I want you to do that favor to me. You have a right to ask. At the same time, I have a right to refuse. Okay, Sureka says, another kind of boundary is recognizing that they only respond to action and not to words. You need to say enough is enough. If you insult me again, if you embarrass me again, then you have to understand that not everybody you lose is a loss. And you need to be willing to get up and walk away. Very good. Clear message that goes across. And even if they pretend to get angry, if they go about spreading bad gossip about you, ignore it. In no time, they get fed up of you and they start looking for other people to prey on, and you are then saved from whatever the unnecessary harassment of such people. Yes, Mangala, what I said was right. No, that after helping, they come with bigger denominations. The moment you oblige them for something small, they come back for bigger things. Can I digress for a moment and tell you, before I read out Sridevi's message, there was a very nice joke. A neighbor comes and asks the neighbor that I need a big, you know, pot or a big dish. Can you lend it to me? This person lends it to him. And he keeps it for a long time. He doesn't return it for a very long time. Finally, he returns it along with a smaller dish. So this person said, the small dish doesn't belong to me. Only the big one I had lent you. The other one said, no, your big dish had a baby. This is the baby of that big dish. So obviously it belongs to you. I'm giving it back to you. This person says, what a fool this fellow is. But anyway, I'm getting a free small dish back. So fine, takes it. The gentleman comes back again after some time and says, can I borrow your big dish? This time he gives it very happily. Then probably I'll get back another small one. And he waits and waits and waits, and the big dish doesn't come back. One fine day he asks him, I want my dish back. He says, oh, very sad to tell you, your dish died. Oh, what ridiculous thing. How can a dish die? He said, how can a dish produce a baby? If a dish can produce a baby, a dish can die also, isn't it? Anyway, that was a joke. We'll move on to what Sridevi has to say. Rightly said, Ali, self-awareness is the key. One should know clearly what's comfortable, and things which discomforts will be easy to set boundaries and not succumb to emotional blackmail. In fact, I went to the extent of saying in the first half that go back into your past and see why certain, you know, issues are not okay with you, certain issues there you are not comfortable. Maybe in your upbringing, certain things have been told to you or indoctrinated into you. What you feel is wrong, set it right. What you feel is what you want to stick to, you stick to those. Okay. Right. Rehana says, we all have our own set of values. Very true. Based on that, we are comfortable operating. That may not be the value for the other person. And hence, that is their way they operate. So boundaries are different for different people, but we need to understand and respect. And I would also add, discuss and explain. I know that your boundaries are different. I mentioned also, no? I know that you lend your vehicle to whoever comes and asks you. So nice of you. That's the way you operate. But I am different. I do not lend my vehicle. So it could be a very simple thing like this also. But when it comes to values, where somebody is trying to impinge on your values, then you not only have to be firm, but explain to them that my values are different from yours. If that person is very comfortable telling lies and he asks you also to tell a lie, you tell, I know. See, I tell lies whenever it is necessary to help somebody, no? So when it is for somebody's help, what's wrong in telling lies? You say, yes, I respect what you are saying. I even appreciate that you go out of the way to help people. But my value system does not allow me to tell lies. So therefore, even if it is for the benefit of somebody, this is the way my upbringing, my indoctrination is. So I will not tell lies. Okay. Surekha also says, daring to set boundaries means having the courage to learn ourselves, even when we risk disappointing others. This is where you have to bring in your own self-respect and your self-esteem. And be ready that you will lose a few friends or relatives. They will not only be unhappy with you, they may even go around spreading gossip about you. It really doesn't matter. You have to stick to it. All this that I've been telling you today about this setting boundaries or developing assertiveness and all that, please remember, this has to be done on a long-term basis. You can't do it once and expect results to come. In fact, I cautioned you that the first time that you do it, there may be a backlash. There may be people who will say wrong or bad things about you. So be ready for it. Don't get perturbed. Don't get disturbed saying, oh, I'm losing friends or my own relatives are talking against me. As long as your conscience is clear, as long as you are sticking to your value systems and things that you approve of or you believe in, it's okay once in a while to lose some friends or some relatives. Even gossip, how long does it last? They will try their best and then they will give up. Shamla says, my daughter's question. When she is with her group of friends, a particular friend of ours takes silent jabs at her to put herself as more superior. My daughter wants to avoid confront her as she is afraid it will ruin the dynamics of the group. Her other friends have noticed and spoken to that girl, asking her to stop. But there's only so much they can do, correct? Should she speak up and confront this friend? Or ignore her and start spending less time with that friend before she ignores and starts spending less time? I would request the child to speak to the other person in a very positive manner, not a critical manner that you are taking jabs at me, you are doing like this, you are trying to put me down. No. Use what we call as the sandwich method. You know, in between the two slices of bread is the vegetable or whatever the thing is inside, right? But they are protected by two slices of bread. So you take the first slice of bread, which is the positive one, and you tell, you're such a nice girl. You're so friendly with us. It's so nice to have you as part of our group and also to have me as a friend. You've been doing so many nice things. You know, one more thing which I wanted to point out was that I have noticed on certain occasions that you may be unhappy, you may be disturbed, but you make some gestures or you make some comments or you say things which, you know, it hurts me. It upsets me. Maybe you're doing it with good intention. Maybe you want me to improve. That's why you say it. But as far as I am concerned, no, I get very upset. Maybe I'm oversensitive. It doesn't matter. But then I don't like this. No, and I don't want our relationship or our friendship to get spoiled. That is the second slice of bread at the end. I want to be your friend. I want to have a good relationship with you. Can we just set these boundaries and remove this irritant so that we can be happy with each other? Similarly, if you have something which I am doing, please tell me. I will rectify and I will change myself and then close it. Give it some time. See if she changes. If she doesn't, then start ignoring her and keeping a distance from here. Surekha rightly says, givers need to set limits because takers seldom do. And takers, why should they set limits? They want more and more and more. And here you are, a Santa Claus who's willing to give whatever they want. They will keep demanding more, but it never helps. Even if you give them anything and everything right up to the beyond your limits also, they will never be happy. That much I can tell you. So keep that in mind. Keep these few points relevant in mind, and to refresh yourself, if you have a minute or two to spare, I will ask Anis to just run you through those slides so that becomes a reminder for you, and also to announce next week's topic. So next Saturday is 27th, and on 27th, I'm going to raise up a debate on having goals, long-term, short-term goals, versus living for the day, enjoying life. Whatever happens, we shall see. Right now, I want to enjoy my life. I want to live one day at a time. So both have their pluses and minuses. We'll have a two-way discussion and conversation on how necessary or how good is it to set goals and plan your future, and how good or how necessary it is to enjoy life and be in your own thing. So I will be seeing you next Saturday on 27th at 2 o'clock on this topic. Thank you.